Perseverance, innovation, humility, self-sacrifice. These are the traits that define a great leader, and these are the traits that define Sokka. Well, eventually. One of the most emotionally satisfying experiences when it comes to movies and TV is watching characters learn and grow, becoming attached to them as their stories unfold and their arcs progress. Meaningful development lets us journey with the characters and invites us to take part in their adventure. There's nothing quite like seeing weakness become strength, timidity change to confidence, and pride evolve into humility. This is especially true in fantasy, a genre rife with examples of the heights to which human beings should aspire. We witness the faith of Luke Skywalker, the self-sacrificial love of Sam Gamgee, and the fatherly wisdom of Iroh, and are inspired to be better than we are. Whether or not their journeys are explicitly laid out on screen or on paper, these and all heroic characters had to suffer and struggle before reaching their potential, making them relatable as well as inspiring, endearing them to the audience. We may not even have liked some of our favorite characters at first, but were transfixed by their development and growth as their arcs progressed. So it is with Sokka, who, by the end of Avatar: The Last Airbender, is confident, assertive, courageous, humble, selfless, and hardly recognizable as the kid we met at the South Pole at the beginning of the show. Let's dive into Sokka's character arc and examine how the creators of Avatar brilliantly crafted it to develop Sokka into a mature, noble leader in a manner that other stories would be wise to use as a blueprint. When we first meet Sokka, he is distrusting, impulsive, and rather misogynistic.
Yes. Thank you.
While all those traits are undesirable, they work excellently for Sokka's character for two reasons. First, they give him room to grow. They show us flaws that he will eventually and gradually conquer in a fulfilling manner. Second, they reflect his age and his situation in life. Sokka is, after all, only 16, and yet he bears the weight of being the tribe's patriarch and has assumed the mantle of its protector. His job is to keep his people safe from external threats, hence his natural predisposition against trusting Aang in the first episode. Sokka's position also forces him to make decisions in the event of a threat, but his immaturity and inexperience cause him to impulsively act on instinct rather than carefully weigh his options. Likewise, the sexism he displays is due to his A, being a teenage boy, and B, living in a society where all the men have gone off to war. Sokka's various flaws and vices are not pulled from thin air. He suffers from them due to where he lives, his culture, and his family. It is no wonder that a young man whose father has been absent due to the war and who can barely remember his mother's face is so reckless, suspicious, and close-minded. His worldview simply wasn't given a chance to expand until Aang showed up. Sokka didn't even realize that water bending could be a martial art, and he'd never met a female warrior before landing on Kyoshi. It is on that island that Sokka begins to show us that he is capable of humility, of acknowledging that he was wrong in his beliefs, that he needs to learn to be a warrior, regardless of his teacher's gender. His humiliation at Suki's hands is not mockery for its own sake, but rather serves as a turning point for Sokka's attitude. In humbly swallowing his pride, he displays growth. Humility is not having a lowly opinion of oneself, but rather having accurate knowledge of one's strengths, flaws, and place in the world. Sokka goes from proudly proclaiming that he is the best warrior in his village to admitting that he knows very little, but is willing to be taught, and he even demonstrates some natural instinct in the martial arts. To be teachable, though, it helps to be perseverant, and that is one virtue that Sokka maintains throughout the show. Like all potentially positive traits, however, perseverance is only a virtue when it is properly ordered. If Sokka had insisted on his status as a warrior, despite the fact that he is inexperienced and unproven, that would technically be perseverance, but to an extreme level that one might rightly call pigheadedness. Instead, Sokka's newly found humility rightly orders his perseverance, enabling him to train purposefully and with dedication under Suki's guidance. This combination of modesty and resolve endears him to Suki. When Sokka admits his own mistakes and shortcomings with genuine honesty, it prompts Suki to open up to him as well. I am a warrior, but I'm a girl, too. There's a simple beauty in seeing two people form a bond through honesty, humility, and open-mindedness. Those same traits prove crucial in Sokka's second Training to be a Warrior episode, Sokka's Master, an episode that, in addition to greatly building Sokka's character, also establishes his necessity to the rest of the team as they idle aimlessly without him. When Sokka is introduced to Pian Dao, the Swordmaster assumes he is going to hear a version of the speech that Sokka earlier gave the Kyoshu Warriors. Pian Dao expects a self-important sales pitch that he's heard 1,000 times. Instead, Sokka tells him, "I'm not sure that I am worthy, and I have a lot to learn." As with Suki, the key to forging this relationship was honesty and humility, not boldness and posturing. That same humility, that accurate recognition of who he is and what he is and is not capable of, enables Sokka to take the lessons he receives from Pian Dao and incorporate them into his own unique style of self-expression. As Pian Dao notes, it is not Sokka's skill with a sword that is his greatest asset, but rather his ability to think creatively and innovate. Any viewer of Avatar The Last Airbender will know Sokka as the idea guy, as well as the meat and sarcasm guy. Sokka certainly never lacks in the creative thinking department. Maybe Disney should hire him to write third acts of their Marvel movies. Putting aside jabs at our corporate overlords, Sokka's ingenuity is displayed early on in Imprisoned with his earthbending style plot to get Katara arrested and then rescue the captured earthbenders. We see his creativity yet again in the Northern Air Temple as he solves both the gas leak problem with the rotten eggs and literally puts a lid on the hot air, enabling the introduction of the Northern Air Temple Air Force. That's great and all, Master Samwise, but how exactly do these examples tie into Sokka's development as a leader? It seems like being creative and innovative is just a flat-out good thing. Well, yes, but again, creativity is a trait that needs to be wielded properly. It is not enough to merely have an idea or a plan. A leader must be flexible, willing to adjust or even abandon plans if necessary, and, more importantly, must be cognizant of the effects on the followers of said plans. To illustrate this, let's take a look at the drill. Sokka's initial plan to cut through a brace of the Fire Nation's machine in order to disable it doesn't work out quite as planned, but he stubbornly attempts to manually shove the gigantic chunk of metal out of position. It is Aang who comes up with the idea to simply weaken the braces and deliver a fatal blow from the top of the drill. To Sokka's credit, he does readily accept this change to his plan, displaying some of that humility he developed earlier in the show. Shortly thereafter, Sokka comes up with yet another idea, this time for Katara to plug up the drill with the slurry it was leaving in its wake. Once again, a good idea, which does in fact work quite well. However, Sokka's attitude toward his sister, who is once again having to do all the work, leaves a little something to be desired. "Just bend the slurry, woman," doesn't exactly scream compassion. A good leader must care for his followers. Leading is not merely knowing what to do, it is a comprehensive understanding of what needs to be done, how each member can contribute toward that goal, and what the cost to that member will be. Truly good leaders are not bosses, but rather are servants. They see to the needs of those following them with compassion. They know how far is too far and how hard is too hard. An effective leader is not always a good leader. Captain Sobel was an effective leader, until he wasn't. Major Winters was a good leader. If you thought I wouldn't sneak a Band of Brothers reference into an Avatar video, you don't know me half as well as I should like. We get significant payoffs for Sokka's growth as a leader in The Day of Black Sun and Boiling Rock. The invasion of the Fire Nation is essentially Sokka's magnum opus of ideas, a culmination of his plans and innovations that began in the library as his persistent attitude drove him to discover the meaning behind the darkest day in Fire Nation history. The invasion force is one he assembled. The plan of attack that will lead them to victory is a product of his own mind. So, naturally, he stutters, stumbles, and generally makes an ass of himself when presenting the plan to his team. But, like Aang tells Sokka, that's just public speaking. His moment of truth will not be on a stage, but on the battlefield. Good leaders lead from the front. They are not defined by their ability to inspire their followers, though that certainly is a bonus. But it is what they do when the hammer meets the anvil that really counts. Think of how much less impactful Theoden's speech would have been if he had then let his riders pass him by as they charged the massed armies of Mordor. But of course, he doesn't. He rides at the front, rides ahead of the Royal Hiram at a pace so fierce none of his host can match it. That was Theoden's moment of truth. Sokka's moment of truth, or at least one of them, does indeed happen during the invasion, but not as he had likely envisioned it. As Hakoda's wound, the Fire Nation's fierce resistance, and most crucially the Fire Lord's absence, push the invasion force and Sokka's planning to their limits, Sokka has to make a tough call. Do they abandon the fight and save as many lives as they can, or do they persist, continuing to hope to win the day? In this crucial moment, Sokka demonstrates caring leadership by deferring to Aang, the person on whose shoulders the burden rests heaviest. Sokka does not ask of anyone anything they do not freely give, but instead gives them the opportunity to fight and to win. When that victory doesn't materialize, we get a payoff for the development of Sokka's adaptability as he makes the call to retreat. He and Toph convincing Aang that now is not the time, that the element of surprise they had counted on had been turned against them. Persistence is only virtuous to a point. If Sokka had insisted on pressing the attack when every advantage was gone, even if that meant simply agreeing with Aang's plan to face Ozai at full power, that would have been stubborn folly. However, Sokka's flexibility only takes him so far, as he insists that, as his submarines are destroyed, their only option is to stand and fight, and he has to be convinced by Hakoda to flee to safety. Even with all the experience Sokka has gained, he still has a thing or two to learn from his father. Thankfully, the story doesn't end there. Sokka intends to make good on his promise to his father that we won't be apart for long this time, and heads to the Boiling Rock with Zuko to rescue Hakoda, but instead he finds Suki and figures, good enough. Seriously, though, how cute are these two? Second best couple in the show after Zuko and his honor. Sokka and Suki's relationship actually highlights another area of growth for Sokka, his compulsive need to protect those he loves and his self-blame. After the loss of Yue, which was not his fault and he could not have prevented, and possibly due to a deep-seated guilt over the loss of his mother, Sokka is overly protective of Suki when they reunite outside Ba Sing Se. He knows Suki is a competent, capable warrior, yet all he can see is the girl he loves once again being put in harm's way, and he reacts accordingly. Of course, Sokka's natural protective instincts are not only commendable, but are necessary for any good leader. He needs to care for the safety of those he leads, but not to the point that he doesn't recognize their agency and ability to help themselves. As with any virtue, Sokka needs to find the healthy golden mean. This will get paid off later, though. Let's return to the prison. What ensues at the Boiling Rock is a conflict between adaptability and persistence. Sokka is willing to change plans and escape with Suki and a few tagalongs. He expresses his regret for having persisted during the invasion, how, if he had cut their losses, this whole mess could have been avoided. It takes Zuko saying, "You have to try every time. You can't quit because you're afraid you might fail," to convince Sokka to keep alive his hopes for Hakoda's rescue. What Sokka lacked was balance and wisdom. His adaptability and persistence should not conflict with each other, but rather one should help balance the other. Knowing when to change plans and when to stay the course requires a thorough understanding of a given situation and of its potential good and bad outcomes. Of all the virtues, wisdom is the most difficult to cultivate, because it requires significant experience and because it is tied into every other virtue. Knowing how to properly use your strengths and compensate for your weaknesses requires right judgment that can only be acquired through repeated failure. Sokka's perseverance and innovative nature were present at the start of the show, and he had learned adaptability, humility, patience, and compassion in relatively short amounts of time. But he struggled to exercise those traits consistently and at the right moments, showing his need to grow in wisdom, even past the halfway point of the final book of the show. In refusing at Zuko's insistence to leave the prison without his father, Sokka demonstrated persistence. By concocting a second escape plan, he showed flexibility. But while the prison break out of Boiling Rock is a big moment for Sokka, the real payoff for his character development as leader comes in the finale. After Iroh has counseled Zuko on the prince's destiny, Sokka turns to the general and asks, "What's our destiny today?" He recognizes Iroh's hard-won wisdom and seeks guidance, but Iroh turns the tables and asks Sokka, "What do you think it is?" Iroh may not know Sokka all that well, but he recognizes his leadership and empowers Sokka to choose the course for himself and his friends. 5 seconds before, Iroh was guiding Zuko through the coming battle and change in power, but he defers to Sokka's decision-making, trusting the young Water Tribe warrior's ability to see the big picture and his place within it. This not only displays Iroh's humility and wisdom, but also that Sokka has reached his apex as a leader. This will be his true defining moment. And oh, what a moment it is. The airship battle gives us everything we could have ever wanted out of Sokka. His ingenuity produces the famous airship slice and the birthday bomb bay plan. He humbly takes a back seat while Toph wipes the floor with the airship bridge crew. When he and Suhi are separated, Sokka perseveres and turns his focus to finishing the mission, paying off his development as he struggled with his perceived failure when Yue turned into the moon. However, none of those moments are quite so impactful as those when we see Sokka being a true servant leader. After he sets the airship on a collision course, Sokka is the last one up the ladder toward safety. When debris begins to rain down around them, he jumps on top of Toph, shielding her body with his own. He doesn't just continue to innovate by instructing Toph to metal bend the rudder, he shows appreciation by complimenting her invention of metal bending. And finally, he clings to Toph's hand as they dangle hundreds of feet in the air, his encouragement met with her, "Aye aye, Captain." Those three words of Toph illustrate one simple fact. She trusts Sokka. Their months of traveling and fighting together and Sokka's growth through his repeated struggles and failures have combined to produce a relationship where Toph, the most independent and self-reliant member of the group, totally entrusts her well-being to Sokka, because he has earned it. Sokka was, from the beginning, a determined protector, an idea guy who could see the big picture and who genuinely cared about those close to him. He was also short-sighted, suspicious, sexist, and was lacking in the wisdom and compassion departments. While his faults obviously weren't desirable, they were understandable, considering his situation in life, and were also necessary for Sokka's growth. As wonderful as it is to see paragons of virtue such as Iroh, who have little if any character development during the show, it is arguably better to witness characters who share our vices and shortcomings, but work to overcome them, even if, or maybe especially if, they consistently stumble throughout their arc. By the finale of the show, Sokka is a decisive, creative, adaptable leader who not only knows the mission and his place in it, but also understands the role of the other members of his team and trusts them to act as needed while simultaneously caring for their well-being and putting it above his own. His incredibly gratifying transformation happens gradually and requires him to seek and receive help and advice from so many others. No one leads in a vacuum. Sokka's fulfillment as a leader came about as he learned to properly relate to care for, trust, encourage, and love those whom he would lead. Well, those are all my thoughts on the matter at hand. There is certainly more that could be said about Sokka, but that's what I've got for now. Let me know your thoughts on Sokka's arc as a leader down below. Hit subscribe for more character analysis and other video essays, whatever other nerd stuff I decide to talk about. And I will see you in the next one. Thank you for watching.